scripture passage that Kathy will be preaching from this morning. It's found on page 1202 in your pew Bible. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 27. So it moves on over to page 1203. Listen now for the word of the Lord. The body is a unit, though it is made up of many parts. And though all its parts are many, they form one body. And so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Now the body is not made up of one part, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has arranged the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty. While our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has combined the members of the body and has given greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Show you watch, has everyone making assumptions about what you believe, vote for or have compassion for. Even the annual family reunion or holiday get-together has folks say, well, let's just don't mention any of these hot subjects. And it doesn't help that we have Facebook, Instagram, forwarded emails, or YouTube to fan the flames. More and more, it feels like we're being set up to be divided. Socialize to look first for all the ways we do not agree, for all the ways we're different, for all the ways we're fearful. Right now, inflammatory words and shocking actions are being used to poke us and prod us and stir us up. Let us not be at the mercy of our gut reactions. And I'm truly not suggesting that we give up passion or compassion. It continues to be important to ask, what would Jesus do? But the church is not a court of law or a political rally. We don't need to win arguments here. We don't need to make our case. And I'm preaching to myself here. That's usually the first one I'm preaching to when I work in a sermon. We should have respect for each other. We can all learn something from each other. And another thing missing sometimes from our conversations is vulnerability. We don't need to act like we know all the answers or strike a self-important pose. But it's not easy to do because we have our human desire to be right. We should ask ourselves, can I believe that God is at work in this other person's journey and in their discernment? Can I accept that this person is created in the image of God? Even though in this moment I'm filled with emotion, disagreement, and discomfort. Do we have to agree on every social issue or biblical interpretation to call ourselves a church family? Do we really feel that those that don't agree with us might not even have a heart? William Sloan Coffin from Riverside Sermon said, church members must constantly remember that the whole gospel is summed up in a three-word imperative, love one another. And in the church, we should concentrate our love not only on the lonely and unloved, the failing and the fallen. We must also love those with whom we disagree. We can take disagreement. Friendship, after all, includes salt and vinegar, as well as sugar. And when all of us are immigrants in God's mighty empire, it does not behoove us to make like minor vassals in charge of our own little fiefs. Yet, despite this challenge, we are to take heart, because the church has been here before. Church fights have been a part of our story since the New Testament. The only time the church has been a time of sunshine and roses was possibly right after Pentecost. It was reported in Acts that the first Christians shared everything in common and praised God with glad and generous hearts, 24/7. Wow. Other than that brief and shiny moment, we've always wrestled with how to be church when we have different points of view. Now, like a lot of people, I'm a child of divorce. My parents divorced when I was a teenager, and it was a horrible time. I'm the oldest of three girls, and the middle one is always going to trial. She's that person that if there's an elephant in the room, she is going to point it out. And when you're a person like me that hates conflict and awkwardness, it was hard. And at the time that my parents were still together, that fight, my sister would go around the house singing an old Tammy Wynette song, D-I-V-O-R-C-E. Talk about awkward. She lost respect for my parents, and instead of calling them mom or daddy, she started calling them by their first names. And of course, this being a small town, everyone in town knew about my parents' problems and shared them with their teenage children and kids at school, kind of started looking at me funny, or maybe I was just kind of parenting. And of course, teenagers don't like to be singled out as different. So, were we still a family through all of this? Were these still my sisters? Were all of our family memories a joke? I remember my best friend calling me one Christmas Eve after she'd been informed by her husband that he no longer loved her and wanted a divorce. And it was so strange to me that the one thing that she kept talking about was, what am I going to do with all those Christmas ornaments that have our names on them? The church at Corinth that Paul wrote this letter to had a wounded division. The congregation was divided by social and economic class, And then the church there started mirroring those in a larger culture, with the elites being the one that were calling all the shots, and everyone else had to just deal with it. Now, some of the elites had conflicts with the leader, and even with Paul himself. They thought he was too weak and too small. So now Paul inserts himself into this church's issues with the scripture that John just read. Now, you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. Paul is saying a reality that does not depend on our agreement of it. We are the body of Christ. Regardless if we're angry with each other, or we don't like each other, or completely disagree with each other, or even if we've hurt each other, God has made us the body of Christ. Not because we signed up for it, or voted on it, or even lived it out. We are the body of Christ because that is what God has made us up to be. Now, God had interrupted the status quo of Corinth. The status quo that says that some people are more important than others. The status quo that proclaimed that they all had to be just alike in order to make it work. The status quo that said that not everyone deserved to be at the same table together. God said, no, I'm creating a new and different community. One that is composed of all of you and all your differences. One that is composed of you all your different gifts. You are the body of Christ, period. Now, it's not surprising that humans tend to gather with people who are like us in some way. We all want to feel safe, and we all want to feel like we belong. We want to be affirmed for who we are and how we are in the world. But we get to thinking about this us and them. And my husband's grandmother used to say, everyone's different but me and thee, and sometimes I wonder about thee. These reactions come from internalized sense of right and wrong that is based on deep-seated expectations and values for which we can't even really find words for. Now, it's the Presbyterian way that our understanding of church is not like a club or a fraternity or a sorority, and we're not a group of like-minded people who enjoy each other's company. A church is just not another voluntary collection of individual members. But by the creative impulse of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, we are the living, breathing body of Christ in this world. The church should be a community of generous listening, a community where we can go into difficult conversations, assuming the good intentions of the other, because they, like we, are different parts of the same body. We Presbyterians pride ourselves on diversity and diverse opinions. We do a lot of work in committees, which we joke about, but we do it because we know we need each other. We know that alone we are incomplete. Together we are stronger. There is a line in one of our historical documents saying, the church protects its own minority point of view as if it were protecting its future, recognizing that the dissenter may well represent the will of God. And that is from the 1993 General Assembly. Will we do what we can to build up relationships with each other? Will we be quick to forgive when we hurt each other? Will we be quick to apologize when we say something stupid or careless? Will we challenge each other in love? Will we do whatever we can to build up the body of Christ rather than tear it down? Despite our differences, will we have equal concern for each other? Will we live like the body of Christ that we are? Dr. Coffin said, human unity is not something we're called on to create, only to recognize. God made us one, and Christ died to keep us that way. We are the body of Christ. May we live that out in such a way that people notice and want to be a part of it. It is who we are. May God strengthen and soften us.